وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه أما بعد. First of all, جزاكم الله خيرًا for those people who have joined us, not only from Massachusetts, not only from New England, but even the entire state and even abroad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us and our families from this pandemic, which have claimed more than 30,000 lives so far. And only in US, we have so many cases. US actually now leads the world with most number of cases for COVID-19 than any other country, with more than 95,000 or almost 100,000 from this morning. And almost each and every country is being under this virus. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, our families, our loved ones. Ameen ya Rab. The reason of this entire online seminar is as this pandemic, as this COVID-19 has become a global disease, global pandemic, the Muslim community is facing new, unprecedented juristic fiqhi issues. And then there are spiritual issues. There's a lot of information. Read this dua 734 times and this will heal your issues and so on and so forth. So there are a spiritual exploitation of the Muslim community. And then there is a fiqhi disagreements which a normal person, a normal Muslim who want to practice his religion, but at the same time he finds himself or she finds himself confused what to do because there are two extreme or two different opinions. So as there is a rampant misinformation and confusion about the global Muslim community, I decided actually to even write a paper, inshallah. Hopefully you will get that paper by tomorrow, inshallah, bi-izni rahman, which have the detail of this entire presentation and this conversation. But I actually just compiled this presentation to give the summary and to create the awareness in the Muslim community that what should we do from the fiqhi standpoint and from the spiritual standpoint, whatever is proven from the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I just want to remind that obviously, whatever I'm saying, I actually gather the scholars who already wrote on this topic within last week. There are 7 to 8 different scholars throughout the Muslim world. I got their research paper. So I just gathered that and I made this presentation. One is my friend and my Sheikh Faraz al-Haq, Ibn Najm al-Haq from Medina. Second is Sheikh Khalil al-Rahman from Islamabad. He wrote a paper. Third is Sheikh Saleh bin Abdul Aziz Sindhi from Medina. Fourth is Sheikh Ahmad bin Muhammad al-Najjar from Libya. Fifth is Sheikh Ibrahim Ibn Amr al-Ruhili from Medina. And sixth is Sheikh Khalid bin Shankith from Qasim, Saudi, and our beloved Dr. Hatim from New Jersey, Amja. So let's start now. What we are going to discuss, inshallah, in this, this is kind of an agenda, what we are going to cover in this presentation. First thing is to analyze the statements of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Rasulullah sallallahu says that there is no disease that Allah has created except that He has also created its treatment. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi is saying this, why we are listing that there is no cure for coronavirus, just to find the fine line between that. Second, analyzing the conversation between Umar radiallahu anhu and other companions regarding plague and lessons extracted from that, a beautiful lesson which will help us to understand the fiqh argument. Third, we are going to discuss, inshallah, in this seminar, divine wisdom behind the plague or behind the coronavirus. Is it a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is the world ending? Is the day of judgment is coming close? Is it the sign of reminder or reflection or warning? What it is? We'll discuss it, inshallah, from the light of Quran and Sunnah. Suggested du'as or recommended du'as, which is suggested by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then fifth is the fiqhi issues, which are rampant nowadays. In the fiqh issues, we are going to discuss these things. What does Islam say about suspending Eid Salah? I hope and I pray that inshallah, before Ramadan, we will going to open our masajid again and we're going to live our regular life. But if that's not the case, can we suspend Eid Salah from the light of Islam, Quran, Sunnah and fiqh? We'll discuss that inshallah. Suspending Taraweeh. I hope and pray again that we will get rid of this, inshallah, from the face of the earth before Ramadan. But Ramadan is within a month and the situation doesn't look good. So we have to be proactive. We have to get ready. What if you have to suspend the Taraweeh? What does Islam say about that? Zakat donations, can we use that for, let's say, for COVID-19 victims? whether for their symmetry cost or for their medical cost. Can we do this? Or even suspending Jum'ah, which is a big chaos in the Muslim community. Some masajid suspended early, some masajid have suspended right now, and some masajid will do in future. But eventually there is a confusion in Muslim community that why we are suspending Jum'ah. What if can we pray Jum'ah at home if there is no Jum'ah happening in the masjid? Or should we pray Zuhr at home? So entire conversation, we will discuss it, inshallah. Can we combine prayer because of the fear of COVID-19? Can we combine Zuhr with Asr and Maghrib with Isha? Why there is a disagreement? What should we do? We'll discuss it, inshallah. We'll also discuss in this seminar can we defer zakah? Because let's say if someone lost a job financially, they are feeling pressure, and if they want to, they can defer the zakah, and for next year they can give twice the amount of zakah. Is there any option in the Sharia? We'll discuss that, inshallah. Also, suspending daily 5-time prayers. What can we do? When can we do this? In terms of congregational 5-time daily prayers, obviously for individual there is no option and there is no question. Praying Eid at home. What does Islam say about concession? All these things we'll try to understand. And wallahi, my intention is not to prove one side of the point. So inshallah, what I will gonna do, I'll try to bring both the sides and both of their argument so that we will have a balanced understanding. And at the end of the day, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our intention for whatever we are doing. And these disagreements are just a kind of flexibility which provides us so that inshallah we can select the best option for our community, because both these sides, if they have both the scholar disagree, both of these scholars have disagreed on one point, it provides us as a community to pick the most flexible argument if they are coming from the right perspective. If you are not coming from the Quran and Sunnah and Sharia fiqh, then obviously you are not even considered as a legitimate disagreement. So we'll discuss that, inshallah. Let's start with, inshallah, the first spiritual side, as I was saying. First, analyzing the statement of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Most of the conversation will be fiqh conversation. So inshallah, we're going to discuss that for 1 hour, 20-30 minutes. But let's discuss this quickly. First, analyzing the statement of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in Sahih Bukhari, "Ma anzalallahu da'an illa anzalalahu shifa." That there is no disease that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala have created except that He has also created its treatment. Now, what does it mean? First of all, there are a few lessons which we can learn from this. First lesson, out of His infinite wisdom, He has created the diseases. He has created the disease. This is what we have to understand. So if someone asks you, who created this coronavirus? Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His infinite wisdom, He has created this coronavirus because He is the creator of everything. Why He created, that will come. That's a divine wisdom for Him. Inshallah, we'll discuss later. So one of the basic ingredients, you can say this just to test His servants. That's why He created. Second, He also said, "Illa anzala lahu shifa," that He have not created any disease except that He have created its treatment. That's the second thing we are learning, that there is no disease in the world that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created without creating its respective cure. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created any disease, it's not possible unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a respective cure. So that's something which is extremely important for us to keep in our mind. Even though modern medical scientists are saying right now that there is no cure for coronavirus, there is no treatment for coronavirus, and obviously they are doing research, they are trying to find out, but we as Muslims, we need to know that this is not true, because as mentioned in this hadith, that Allah says, Allah's messenger says, Allah have created the cure with the disease. So our modern day people are either too ignorant to know that cure right now, or they are too arrogant to accept the reality that they don't know. This is what we are learning here. Also, in Surah Falaq, we are asked by Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that when you are reciting Surah Al-Falaq, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقْ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا خَلَقْ. I seek the protection of Allah from all the evils of His creation, which includes actually the creation, includes the diseases, the bacteria, the viruses, it includes that. So you are asking Allah's refuge and protection even when you're reciting Surah Al-Falaq. From this hadith, we are also learning that it's a responsibility of Muslim doctors and generally the scientist community, even Muslim and non-Muslim, to keep searching for the cure, in the diseases by doing different experiments, as stated by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is a responsibility of Muslim doctor and the scientist community, subhanallah, to help to offer a solution to the humanity. The disease which is mentioned in this hadith, which says ma anzalallahu da'an, there is no disease that Allah has created, even include the coronavirus, even include the contagious disease which spreads from the animals. It includes every disease. One thing which is extremely important, it's not acceptable for a Muslim to surrender to any disease, whether physically, spiritually, psychologically, and to say, okay, this is the punishment of Allah, I don't need to do anything, I need to repent only, don't need to do the medical part. No, we should strive hard to find cures in the light of the above mentioned hadith. And the reason for it, if you go back in the history, in the golden age of Muslim community, we had great Muslim doctors, subhanAllah. Like in 10th century, we had a medical scientist, Az-Zahrawi, who invented almost 200 medical instruments, some of which are still used today, subhanAllah, like surgical needles. And Az-Zahrawi actually wrote a encyclopedia of medicine in 10th century, I'm talking about, 30-volume book named At-Tasrif. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to revive this legacy. You know, back in the days when our great Muslim scientists were doing this in 10th century, the other faith-based communities, they were saying that these diseases are the punishment of God. So they were surrendering intellectually. While we know that one aspect of these things is a punishment, not all one aspect, but there is no way you can surrender. You need to make your effort to come out of it, to get rid of this. This is a Muslim attitude, how to deal with this disease. Second, moving on. This is another thing which happened at the time of Sahaba. There's a big plague which affected the area of Syria, Sham, and it just affected everyone in that area. Almost 25,000 to 30,000 companions passed away, well-known companions passed away during this plague. Along companions, Tabi'in, both. I just want to mention one hadith from Bukhari, and we will learn how did Sahaba come to the solution of dealing with that unprecedented plague, and we will apply into our situation in the modern day, inshallah. Okay, so just listen to the story, and then we will going to extract the lesson that how we can learn that how the Sahaba extracted this lesson from the unprecedented story. So let's start in Bukhari. First, it's mentioned that Umar radiallahu anhu, he heard that there's a plague in the Sham area, in the Syria area, and he appointed Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah as a leader of that area after removing Khalid ibn Walid. So he's the leader now. And Umar radiallahu anhu took few companions from Medina as a Khalifa, as a leader. He said, okay, let me march towards the Syria to see what's going on, because he is the leader who wants to lead his people from the front. He doesn't want to stay back. He was not afraid for himself. So he actually marches towards the Syria. Then as soon as he reaches to the border of Syria, the people from the Syria, the leaders, the delegates, including Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, came out just to as a delegation, as a protocol to welcome the leader. When Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah came out as a governor, he came out and he saw and he gave the updates to Umar ibn al-Khattab as a Khalifa. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu started getting this advice that this is not the right time for you, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar, to go inside. So then Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, okay, let me take advice and counsel. He then take advice from three different groups. First, he take advice from the Muhajir, the people who migrated to Medina from Mecca, and those who were alive. They ask, or Umar asked to them, what should we do? Should we go inside? Should we go back to Medina? So they disagreed. فَخْتَلَفُوا. The people of Muhajir who were in Syria, they disagreed. Some of them said, Umar, go inside. Don't worry. Just do tawakkul on Allah. Trust Allah. The other group said, no, Umar, go back to Medina. Because there's a plague. If something will happen, if you will die, if companions with you from Medina, they will die, there will be a huge loss. Go back to Medina. Don't go inside. So there's back and forth argument. So Muhajir companions disagreed. They didn't give any clear answer. Then Umar radiallahu anhu said, okay, let's call Ansar companions, the companions who were local to the Medina, and now they are actually moving. I'll come to that, Sister Asima, inshallah. That's the concluding of the hadith. Then the Ansar companions came, and then the Ansar companions came, and then they also disagreed. Some said, Umar, just come inside, And sometimes, no, just stay outside. Obviously, the rationale for them, they didn't know this hadith until Abdurrahman ibn Auf will come and clarify this. They are saying that, okay, if you go inside, just do trust of Allah, you came for a reason, just go ahead. The other companions said, no, it will be a big loss if you will come inside during this plague, everyone is dying, you will also lose your life, so it's a big loss. Just go back to Medina. So that's as a rationale. Then the Muhajir disagreed, Ansar disagreed. It's still Umar radiallahu anhu is seeking advice. Then he sought advice from the third group of companions, which is the people of the Quraysh who migrated after Fath Makkah. And then they said that, okay, you should go back, you should not come inside. After listening to all of their advice and their disagreement, Umar radiallahu anhu said, okay, we are actually going back to Medina and we are not going inside. Although Sahabas disagreed, major Sahaba disagreed. When he said this, that we are actually not going inside, we are going back to Medina because there's a plague inside. And you know the personality of Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar is not the person who will get worried for himself, subhanAllah. Because there's another group of companions also with him, and then his status as a Khalifa, if anything will happen to him, what will happen? As soon as he said that we are going back to Medina, this is the statement came from the leader of Syria, Abu Ubadah ibn al-Jarrah. So he said, قَالَ أَبُو عُبَادَ ibn al-Jarrah أَفِرَارًا مِّن قَدَرِ اللَّهِ. Abu Ubadah says, are you going to run away from the divine decree, Ya Umar? He says, Umar, are you running away from the Qadr of Allah? And the selection of the word Qadr is so beautiful because nowadays we abuse this word, subhanAllah. So he says, are you running away from the Qadr of Allah? Means whatever Allah have written for you in your destiny, that will happen. Are you running away from death? If Allah have written death for you, you are going to die in Medina. Are you running away from that? So this is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. He's saying this. Who is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah? He's actually one of the companions who got glad tidings of Jannah from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Ashra Mubashra. He was one of those companions who Umar radiallahu anhu said, if Abu Ubaidah was alive after my death, I would have made him a Khalifa after me. Such a high status Abu Ubaidah had among the companions. Rasulullah says he's the Amin of the Ummah, custodian of the Ummah, trustworthy of the Ummah. Such a high status. And he's saying to Umar, why don't you trust Allah? Are you running away from the decree of Allah? Okay, now. Then Umar gave this the most powerful, historical, and balanced response, which is very popular these days. Umar said, Naam, yes, Abu Ubaidah, Nafirru min qadarillah ila qadarillah. Yes, you are asking me I'm running away from decree of Allah? Yes. We are running away from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah. This is such a powerful, powerful response. You know what does it mean? I will give the details later. But this means, see, if I have to die, I will die in Medina. That there is no way I can escape that. That is inevitable. But I have to make efforts. I don't have to commit suicide. That is something which we learn from the statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. And we'll extract more lessons, inshallah, as we'll move on, inshallah. While they were discussing this, Umar said this, okay, we are going back, and this is the reason. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah says, Afirar min qadarillah. Abdurrahman ibn Auf came, and he was doing something, some important thing. He came back and he heard this conversation between two great companions. And he says, actually, you know, in haza ilmun indi, that I have a knowledge about this from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what you guys are talking about. So Umar and Abu Ubaidah, they're discussing, and as soon as they heard that now someone have knowledge from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about this topic, so they both said, okay, please go ahead. What did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say about this situation? Because the habits of the companions, whenever the hadith is being quoted, they would say, okay, let's follow the hadith. So Abu Abdurrahman ibn Auf said, I heard that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ بِأَرْضٍ فَلَا فَلَا تَقْدَمُوا عَلَيْهِ وَإِذَا وَقَعَ بِأَرْضٍ وَأَنْتُمْ بِهَا فَلَا تَخْرُجُوا فِرَارًا مِنْ. He says that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if you hear a ta'un, a plague, an outbreak of plague in a land, and you are outside of that land, do not enter it. And if it spreads in the land where you are there, then do not go outside. just to damage control so that the virus, the plague won't spread. Stay inside. Don't go outside. And if you're outside, don't come inside. This is the advice which Abdurrahman ibn Auf gave through the prophetic tradition to Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And actually, if you see this hadith, this goes back to the decision which Umar took, that okay, we are not going inside, we are going back to Medina. So this hadith confirms. So now when Umar radiallahu anhu heard this hadith coming from Abdurrahman ibn Auf, he didn't brag. He says, Abu Ubaidah, see, you didn't have any knowledge. I had a knowledge. I made a decision which is confirmed from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam hadith. He actually says, Fahamidallah, he actually praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving him that understanding which is confirmed from the hadith also, subhanallah. Okay, now, what are the lessons we are learning from this? Number one lesson, which is very practical, from this entire story, number one lesson, even the Sahaba of the prophets, who were the best people after the messengers, they had disagreement. They had disagreement. If Sahabas had disagreement, and they both were okay with that, who are modern-day scholars? They are bound to disagree. If Sahabas who were facing this pandemic or this, let's say, epidemic in that Syria area, for it's an unprecedented issue for them, and they disagreed and they were respectful to each other, then today's scholars were going to disagree, and they should not forget that they should be respectful to each other. One group should not smack other group on social media. That's not prophetic. That's not following the legacy of the Sahaba. Sahaba had disagreement. This is number one lesson we are learning. The Muhajir, the Ansar, even the great companions like Abu Ubaidah, Ibn al-Jarrah, and Umar ibn al-Khattab had disagreement, but they were respectful to each other. Never forget the respect which a Muslim owe to other Muslims, subhanAllah. Second, Umar radiallahu anhu, although he was a leader, but before making any important decision, he would take counsel. He would take advice. He's not saying, okay, I'll make decision because Allah has given me authority. No, he would take advice and counsel from all possible people. Nowadays, if you have to take advice of pandemic, you have to take advice not only from scholars, but even from medical doctors, even from the political authorities, CDC, so on and so forth, governor. Then you have to make decisions, subhanAllah. So following the sunnah of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. One more lesson we are learning from this incident, if you're writing it down. It is good to have this difference of opinion. It is good to have this disagreement because it gives you the flexibility to select the most appropriate one for your situation. See, if people would have only heard Abu Ubaidah al-Jarrah and they wouldn't have heard the opinion of Umar al-Khattab, there would have been a disaster. So they listen to both the opinions. And then eventually it's confirmed by Abdurrahman ibn Auf that there's a hadith on this. So now it provides the flexibility to the people or the leader to pick whatever is strong or compatible with the environment. And this is what actually said by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah also. He says disagreement among classical scholars is a source of mercy and their agreement is a clear-cut evidence. اختلافهم رحمة واسعة وإجماعهم حجة قاطعة. He says in Majmu' al-Fatawa. One more thing which you were going to see. A sequence here is extremely important. He did not say, okay, we're going to trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First, he took advice. Then he compared the advice. And then he made a decision. So when you use the word tawakkul or qadr, before that you do your effort. Take best possible advice. And then trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is extremely, extremely important, subhanAllah. Do the planning, do the counseling, then make a decision, and then trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what we are learning from the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu. And time we are even learning this sequence from the Quran also. If you do this, the blind faith, blind following in Islam is neither expected nor accepted. You have to use your planning, use your counseling, taking advice, then make a decision, and then tawakkul will come. Even from the other places of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking his messenger prophet, he says in Surah Ali Imran, وَشَّاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. Take advice from the people. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ. After taking the advice, take a best decision. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. And then do tawakkul. The sequence is extremely, extremely important. One more lesson we are learning from this entire story. Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah was one of the greatest companion and was given the glad tidings of Jannah by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even then, his opinion was challenged and refuted and later on confirmed that counter opinion is solid. It means that the opinion of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah, no matter how high his status is, his ijtihad, his juristic opinion was not in line with the Sharia as compared to Umar ijtihad was, as compared to Umar opinion was, which tells us one thing. No matter how big a scholar you are, no matter how big sheikh you are, we will never reach to the level of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. If their opinions are being challenged and refuted, who are we? We did not even come out of our diapers, the modern day scholars, as compared to Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah and the Sahaba. We are nowhere closer to them. But their opinions were challenged and they were humble about that. This is something which we need to keep in our mind. What did we learn when he says, نَفِرُّ مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ إِلَىٰ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ? By the way, if you want to have ask any questions, you can write on the chat box, inshallah. What does it mean when he says, نَفِرُّ مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ إِلَىٰ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ? There are so many lessons we can learn from this, subhanAllah. First, when he says, yes, we are going away from the Qadr of Allah, from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah. First lesson, it is a religious obligation for all of us not to commit suicide, to take all the precautions to protect ourselves and each other from the harm of contagious disease. After taking all the preventive measures, which you got from the advice of the experts, then put trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what we are learning from the statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He did not say, no, I trust Allah, I will go inside. No. He took advice of the people, he measured, and then he moved on. Second, death is inevitable. This is also we are learning from the statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab. We have to strive hard in this world until the last breath, but we have to understand death is inevitable. If I have to die in Medina, I will die in Medina. No matter how much I can make efforts to stay away from coronavirus, 2-3 days ago, I got the text that actually one of my friend's son, he was 27-year-old in New Jersey, he got heart attack, passed away. 27-year-old, heart attack, died. When people are dying from coronavirus, we forgot about other things, subhanAllah. So that is inevitable. But yes, should we just put our hand into the fire by claiming that Ibrahim al-Islam did not get burned? No! This is suicide. This is haram. You have to make efforts because Ibrahim al-Islam, that was a miraculous sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Neither you nor I, we are not Ibrahim al-Islam. So this is something which we have to remember. One fascinating aspect of the statement of Umar radiallahu anhu is the word he uses, qadr. He says, we are running from the qadr of Allah to the qadr of Allah, from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah, which is unfortunately abused in our times. As Muslims, we believe that Allah has decreed everything for us, everything. However, we still have a responsibility to make plans, tadbir, and then put our utmost efforts in everything we do. Otherwise, why you go for a job? Just resign and then wait for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send manna wa salwa for you in-house. So you have to make an effort and then you have to put trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawakkul is actually a beautiful concept in Islam. And even after making your efforts, if things are not going in your way, you are having trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah have other plans for you. This is the beauty of tawakkul. But if you abuse tawakkul from the beauty, this might become ugly concept. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to use this word in a proper context. For more detail, I actually wrote an entire chapter on tawakkul in my thesis, PhD thesis. It's in Arabic, on where I wrote Tafsir of Surah Yusuf. I wrote an entire subchapter on tawakkul and eradicating misunderstandings. For detail, you can read that, inshallah. One more thing we are learning from this statement. Self-quarantine is an Islamic concept that was given to limit the spread of disease and to defer damage control. This is an Islamic concept. Obviously, modern day people came up with the idea of self-quarantine, self-isolation, social distancing, but this is an Islamic concept because Rasulullah ﷺ says, if there is an outbreak in one land, do not go out and do not come in, just to do the damage control, spread the outbreak of the virus from that area. Last thing, inshallah, before we can move on. Last lesson we are learning, when there is a new and unprecedented issue, how did Sahaba face? When there is a new and unprecedented issue, as a leader, you have to show the flexibility and you have to take every possible advice, like Umar said. Umar did not say, okay, let's take the Muhajir companions and leave the Ansar. No, he took advice from each and every person. You have to show the flexibility, and you have to take every possible advice and recommendation presented to you before making a decision. And then you have to make a decision which is easy for the people and save people lives, which will save the life of people. Umar can easily say, okay, are we more of a believer than Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh? No one can claim this. But even Umar said, okay, I'm going back to Medina. And then confirmed from the hadith of Abdurrahman, narrated Abdurrahman ibn Auf. Even there is a hadith, although some scholars said this is a weak hadith in Tirmizi, which I'm about to say. But all the four imams actually use this hadith in their fiqh works of Kitab al-Hudud. So this hadith, actually, the one part of the hadith says, فَإِنَّ الْإِمَامَ أَن يُخْطِيَ فِي الْعَفْوِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَن يُخْطِيَ فِي الْعُقُوبَةِ. Rasulullah s.a.w. says, indeed, if the imam makes an error, if the imam makes a mistake on the side of leniency, it is better than imam making a mistake on the side of severity. This hadith is mentioned in Kitab al-Hudud, in almost all the books. I'll answer your questions, inshallah. Let me just finish this, inshallah. And also, there are so many hadiths about tying the camel and addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I'm skipping that, inshallah. Before I can move on, just let me answer one or two questions which we have, inshallah. Multiple opinions from scholars might cause confusion among ordinary Muslim imams. Please comment. Brother Shafiqur Rahman, I was going to mention this in the beginning of the fiqh chapter. So within 15 minutes, I was going to end this, inshallah. And we'll start the fiqh, which is the major discussion of our topic, inshallah. So I'll address this, inshallah. I agree that as a regular person, yes, Sister Fatima, please, you can ask the question, inshallah. If I know, I will answer, inshallah. Is it going to be recorded? Yes, inshallah, hopefully. Yeah. Oh, subhanAllah, I am not recording it, but hopefully Brother Nabil is recording it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him the ability to record it, inshallah.
It is being
recorded. Okay, alhamdulillah, it's being recorded. Okay, let's start now. This last chapter before we can go to the main core, spicy fiqh issue, inshallah, which I discussed, and there's multiple fiqh issue regarding Salah, Jum'ah, Eid, Taraweeh, deferring Zakah for the bad economy, so on and so forth. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give barakah in the time, because it's already 32 minutes past. I was expecting that I will finish the first part within 30 minutes. So let's finish this quickly, inshallah. Divine wisdom behind the disasters, behind the plague, especially this, let's take this epidemic of coronavirus and suggested du'as. Jazakallah khairan to Brother Saad Mufti and Brother Nabil to work on these slides, subhanAllah. These were not colors which I put. I just gave them a random draft and they, mashallah, edited all these slides. Okay, the wisdom behind the natural disasters, calamities. These are the possible reasons which I could found from different ahadiths and different books. And I will just mention you the brief summary of that, inshallah. There are two aspects to it. One is individual aspect and the second one is collective aspect. Again, don't mix this up, otherwise you will going to get confused. One is individually why Allah send a plague and why individual impact will be faced. And then there will be a collective reasoning behind this. For individual, I'm going to mention a few things, but for detail, I would recommend to listen to one of the lectures on YouTube, Why Bad Things Happen. I gave that last year in ICNA convention. Wallahi, this is not self-marketing. I gave 30 minutes on that, so I'm avoiding that time. I don't want to repeat myself. You can, again, YouTube, why bad things happen, why me, Imam Asif Rani, you will, inshallah, find the answer. But I'll just give you the summary, inshallah. From an individual perspective, I'll come to that, Sister Shazia, inshallah, jazakallahu khairan. From the individual perspective, the first wisdom, actually, let me tell you the hadith. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. When the same question was asked to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, same question was asked to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Aisha Siddiqa radiyallahu anha in Bukhari, she asked, "Sa'altu anit ta'un." Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, can you tell me about plague? Are they punishment? Are they mercy? Are they love? What are they? Why Allah sent plague? This question was asked to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. And in Bukhari, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says this, أَنَّهُ عَذَابٌ يَبْعَثَهُ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, first, yes, it is a punishment set by Allah for those people whom He wants to punish. Not everyone, but there are a certain group of people, bad people, Allah wants to punish them, and it is a punishment for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from this punishment. Ameen, Ya Rab. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Wa anna Allah ja'alahu rahmatan lil mu'minin." That Allah, and at the same time, this plague, this contagious virus, Allah made it a source of mercy for the believers. So the same thing can be a punishment for someone, and the same thing can be a mercy for someone. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Imam Asif, how can a person who has a confirmed positive case for coronavirus, he's struggling, and he has a severe case, not a mild case, how it's a mercy for him or her? Then actually, Rasulullah gave this answer. In the same hadith, he says, لَيْسَ مِنْ أَحَدٍ يَقَعُ الطَّاعُونَ فَيَمْكُثُ فِي بَلَدِهِ صَابِرًا مُحْتَصِبًا يَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ لَا يُصِيبُهُ إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ إِلَّا كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِ الشَّهِيدِ. Rasulullah says, the way it will become mercy for you if you are struggling with coronavirus is that if you are patient during that sickness and during that disease, and you are staying in your place, you're not leaving your place to spread it. You are staying in your place, whether at your home, or whether at your city, or whether in your town, you're not leaving. You're not spreading it. So you're patient in your home, and you're not leaving. And then you are, you know that whatever Allah wrote for you, that will gonna happen. Then Rasulullah says, إِلَّا كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِ الشَّهِيدِ. If this is your case, during coronavirus, if you are struggling with coronavirus, whether mild or severe case, if this is your case, then you are going to get reward of a martyr, of a shaheed. And who doesn't want that? Allahumma arzuqna shahadatan fi sabil. Ameen ya Rab. This is hadith mentioned in Sahih Bukhari. By the way, Hafiz ibn Hajar mentions this, that for this clearly says, for this you doesn't need to die. Even if you survive after the mild case or after severe case, still you're going to get the reward of the shaheed, because the Rasulullah didn't say that you have to die for this. But you just have to be patient. You don't need to go out to spread to the people. And then at the same time, you have to believe that whatever Allah has willed, that's going to happen, inshallah. From the other perspective, it's a love also from the individual perspective. For detail, you can listen to that lecture on YouTube. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. That no doubt, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves His servant, male or female, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put them under difficulty and adversity. This is hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ خَيْرْ بِهِ يُصِبَّ مِنْ يُصَبَّ مِنْ. In Muslim, Rasulullah says, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give anything good to the servants, He would put difficulty on them, because in difficulty you will come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are distracted normally. So this is a kind of love. This is a kind of mercy, as said in Rasulullah's hadith, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then this is a warning also. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, one of the reasons why He sent punishment in the Quran, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Hopefully they will come back after getting those tough days, because humanity have been distracted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know the unfortunate part for the last 2 weeks, ever since lockdown started, instead of coming close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muslims and non-Muslim, both, regardless of the faith, instead of going back to that higher authority, what we are doing, we are actually, subhanAllah, this is so disturbing. I was looking at the statistics of one of the websites, porn websites. They said that for last 2 weeks, there was a spike of 27%. So people are consuming pornography in their home because they are confined in their homes because of the disease outside. If coronavirus won't kill you, then this will kill you from inside. So take this as a warning sign and come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One more thing is that humbleness. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says this. Many a times you will become arrogant. That, I don't need Allah in my life. Whatever I touch, it turns gold. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to teach you a lesson, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will going to put you under trouble individually, so that you will become more humble, and you will your arrogance, your ego will be crushed completely. This is also one of the reasons. Let's start the collective reason. Collective reason of why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send these punishments, send these plagues. First is, as Allah says in Surah Al-Rumah, at number 41, ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ لِيُذِيقَهُمْ بَعْدَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Allah says clearly in Surah Al-Rumah, at number 41, corruption has appeared throughout the land and sea by the reason of what the hands of the people have earned so. It's just the slight punishment of what we are doing as a corruption, as a community. Why Allah sent this? لِيُزِيقَهُمْ بَعْدَ الَّذِي عَمِلُوا. He does it so that they may taste some of the consequences of what they are doing. And why? Because لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Hopefully they will come back after receiving this punishment. So one of the collective reasons, according to this ayah, is collectively when we tend to become corrupt as a society, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send these reminders every now and then so that hopefully we can go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an entire community, humanity. No matter how rebellious politician you were, now I'm looking at each and every politician asking their community, make dua in the places of worship, because now you need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you know what interesting concept is? Allah doesn't criticize this mentality that when you need Allah, you will come. This is selfish mentality. No, Allah doesn't say this is selfish. Allah really loves this. When you need Allah, you will come back to Him. Allah is waiting for us to go back to Him. What Allah criticizes actually, that once you come back to Him and He have removed the hardship, then you will go back to your routine life, to the haram thing. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and alleviate and to lift this plague and this disease, inshallah, so that we can go back to our routine life. Ameen, Ya Rab. One of the other hadith, we'll move on, inshallah, with this. This is the last thing. One of the other hadith which says about one of the reasons why Allah sent this contagious viral disease is vulgarity and obscenity and immorality. There's a big hadith, but I'll just mention the first part of it. In Ibn Majah, Sahih hadith, Abdullah ibn Umar said, Rasulullah sallallahu said, Ya ma'ashar al-muhajirin khamsu iza ibtulaytum bihinna wada'u bihilla abillah ay antudrikuhunna wa'audhu billahi antudrikuhunna. He said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu turned to us and said, O Muhajirun, O people, O my companions, there are five things with which you will be tested, and I'll seek Allah's refuge that you will live to see them. They will be so severe. One of them will be, لَمْ تَزْهَرَ الْفَاحِشَ فِي قَوْمٍ قَطْ. Immorality, vulgarity, obscenity never appears among a people to such a higher level that they come it openly, except that plagues and diseases that were never known among the predecessors will spread among them. This is hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That these unknown diseases, these unique diseases, plagues and viral contagious diseases, ta'un, will going to spread when you will going to commit as a society immorality. We have premarital relationship, extramarital relationship, and then homosexuality and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says through His wisdom, through Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when you are going to cross the limits of immorality, then just to teach you a lesson, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to send you the diseases which were never heard before. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins and lift this plague and this virus, inshallah. Okay, before we can start, let me just take two questions, inshallah. As you mentioned in the beginning, what is the significance of number in Islam? People say you should read this word 314 times. That's coming, Sister Shazia, that's coming. That's what we have to discuss right now. Also, Assalamu alaikum, is it true that even if you don't get infected by life through and survive through the plague, three threats? Yes, Sister Saadi and Adnan is asking, if you will survive and you won't die, even if and you will be patient and then you will have those characteristics which mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, will you still get Jannah? Hafiz ibn Hajar, a scholar of who wrote the commentary of Sahih Bukhari, he says, still you will get Jannah if you are affected and you are not leaving your house and you are making sure it doesn't become contagious and spoils life of others and you are patient, still you will get the reward of Shaheed, because Rasulullah didn't say that you have to die for it. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the reward of Shahada and we should stay home, inshallah. Okay, so let's start now. One thing you have to understand before I can tell you suggested du'as. Rule of thumb for the du'a. Du'a should not be reading. Du'a is about actually asking. There are two different things, reading and asking. And I'll actually tell you this. You know, this is interesting, subhanAllah. Yes. I completely agree, whoever it NA0209, that this is one of the kinds of punishment, as we said, is waging war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by indulging ourselves constantly in the riba. Because Allah says, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ in Surah Al-Baqarah, that this is actually harb, war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek repentance and to leave the life of haram. Ameen, Ya Rab. Okay, so now let's start. Rule of thumb. Dua is not reading, dua is asking. Just imagine your son or your daughter comes to you, and if they want to ask you something, would they talk to you and ask you, or would they read from the phone? Abba, with all due respect, I want this Play-Doh from the Walmart. It's $5.99. Jazakallahu khairan. You would feel so that this is so far away from being genuine. Your son will come, your daughter will come, and they will ask you, even if their language is broken, but you will appreciate the tears coming from their eyes, the emotions coming from them. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your own language. That's the best thing you can do. But yes, there are few du'as which are recommended by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which we should abide by every single day, especially in these times. And we'll talk about asking du'as which are not recommended by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam or any scholar, but maybe someone is suggesting without giving a reference, what should we do? Okay, let's start now. So first du'a which is recommended by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is this du'a. In Abu Dawud, actually, Rasulullah s.a.w. says, whoever reads this dua thrice in the morning and thrice in the evening, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect them from harm and from sudden affliction. So this is based on revelation. So definitely we can use these three number. Why these three number? Because Rasulullah s.a.w. said this in Sahih Hadith. Bismillah allazi la yadurru ma'asmihi shay'un fil ardi wa la fis samai wa huwa samiyul alim. If you are not asking this dua, make the habit, and especially in these days, may start a habit. In the name of Allah, with whose name nothing can harm me, nothing can harm me on earth and on the sky, on the heaven. He is all hearing, all knowing. This is a dua we should make a habit of asking and memorizing it. Thrice in the morning, thrice in the evening, as said by Rasulullah SAW. Where do we get this number? Hadith of Abu Dawud. Actually, before we can go on to the hadith, I'll tell you just two other things apart from dua. Seeking forgiveness is also highly recommended during these days. Because as I said, that collectively we are doing something bad, that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this plague. Seek forgiveness. Consistently forgiveness. Apart from seeking forgiveness, even we should actually make a habit of sending salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Peace and blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because in one hadith of Tirmizi, Sahih Hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa after mentioning the benefits of sending the salawat, he says, "Isn't takfi hammat wa yakthir dhambak?" One of the benefits of sending salawat on me, peace and mercy on me, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will going to, your concerns will be taken care of and your sins will be forgiven. So Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he wrote actually, this will remove the plague or the any disease also, because Allah's Messenger is saying your concerns will be taken away. And at the time of plague, at the time of contagious disease, that's one of the concerns. So it will be taken away. That's one of the benefits. Okay, let's move on. One of the other dua which is proven from Sahih Muslim, Rasulullah says, make this dua three times daily for protection for all the evils. That's A'udhu bi kalimatillahi ta'ammati min sharri ma khalaq. Whenever I'm telling you this dua, do not read this dua in foreign language. If you don't know Arabic, ask in English. Ask in Urdu. Ask in Bengali. Ask in Indonesian language, Turkish. Ask in your own language three times. If you don't know Arabic, no worries. I seek refuge in the perfect words of Allah from the evil of that which He has created. And when we say min sharri ma khalaq, from the evils of what He has created, it includes the coronavirus also. Third dua, which is suggested by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Third dua is, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-baras wal-junoon wal-judham wa min sayyil asqam. Oh Allah, I seek your refuge from the leprosy and from the insanity and from paralysis and from evil diseases. This is again, Rasulullah said in Sunan Abu Dawud, he used to taught this dua to the companions during the time of epidemic. So you need to stay firm on this dua. One other dua which is proven from Sahih Muslim is, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika bihi min zawali ni'matik wa tahwil afiyatik fujaati naqmatik wa jami'i sakhatik. O Allah, I seek refuge with you from the withdrawing of your blessings and the loss of the well-being that you granted me and the sudden onset of your wrath and anything that you lead that may lead to your displeasure. This mentioned Sahih Muslim. These du'as are proven from Rasulullah, so you should ask this du'a in your own language, inshallah. Then there is one more du'a, which is actually proven, that Rasulullah says, you should call Allah with the name, with the dua of Dhinnun. Dhinnun is actually Yunus alayhi salam. That when he was huwa fi batn al-hut, when he was in the belly of the whale, he asked, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. So he asked this dua, that there is no one worthy of worship except you, O Allah. You are pure. Purity is for you. No doubt I am from the wrongdoers. I did something wrong. Rasulullah says, فَإِنَّهُ لَمْ يَضَعْ بِهَا رَجُلٌ مُسْلِمٌ فِي شَيْءٍ قَطٌ إِلَّا إِسْتَجَابَ اللَّهُ لَهُ. Rasulullah says, if a Muslim make this dua, لَا إِلَّا إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. If a Muslim make this dua, in any matter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to their dua. So we should make this habit of asking dua. And there are other duas also. There are duas, اللهم إني أسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. And then there are other duas. There is قُلُوا اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ thrice in the morning, thrice in the evening. That's mentioned in Sahih Hadith. The point here is that if you are asking these duas, then ask in your own language if you don't know Arabic. And if you want to mix both, that will also be great. But it should come from heart. It should not only come from mouth. Your attention, your emotions, all should be there. You should pay attention. What does these duas mean? If it will come from heart, it will come like a genuine dua. Otherwise, you're reading dua in a foreign language without asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, regarding few questions which people asked, should we concern the prerequisite for one's dua to be accepted? Are you asking about the prerequisites for dua? Generally, there are no prerequisites for these duas. As we know that there are... For the salah, you have to prerequisite is wudu, but for du'as, there is no prerequisite. Does doing istighfar help protect us during these difficult times? Yes. That's what I said. Seeking forgiveness is istighfar. The number one thing I said, seek forgiveness. And seeking forgiveness does not only mean to say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah only. Say astaghfirullah and have an intention to leave the life of sin. Make practical steps towards coming out of the life of sin. This is also istighfar. You can't hear me? Please confirm, because I guess everyone else can hear me right now. Okay. One thing which I would actually like to clarify. Should we ask this dua of, let's say, ABC dua, which is not proven from the hadith or any sahaba or any earlier scholar from the sahaba or tabi'in, and maybe one sheikh, one imam of the masjid is saying, ask this dua of 314 times and 593 times. So if you will ask that dua without specifying the number, if that dua have a beautiful meaning, it's fine. Just like if Sheikh Sudais is asking a dua, even though that's not proven from the sunnah, I've listened to the haram recitation and I was saying, the dua is so beautiful, let me memorize this dua because the dua meaning is so powerful. If this is your intention, it's fine. As long as the restriction of numbers are not there. But if you are saying, no, you have to recite this dua 736 times, and there's no proof from the sunnah, no proof from the sahaba, no proof from the earlier scholar, then we would say this came from outside. We can safely say it came from outside, and we don't have to abide by those numbering, unless there is an evidence from the earlier generation. Second, what about giving extra adhan to avert hardship? And there in some Muslim countries, people were asking me, that okay, people are giving azan on the streets, on the masjid, extra azan, apart from five-time azan, to avert hardship. So from the religious standpoint, I don't know of any Quranic ayah, any sahih hadith, and even any of the four imams who have said that azan can be given, extra azan, to avert hardship. There is one weak hadith in Tabarani, which is extremely weak, that cannot be used for changing the original principle. And if azan will avert the hardship, you're already giving five azan. That will be more than enough to avert the hardship. So in those countries, they were asking to give the sixth azan, the seventh azan. That's not proven from anyone. So we should do whatever is proven, and we should find the practical things instead of inventing these new things, inshallah. Okay, before we can start the fiqh discussion, which is the crust of this topic right now, inshallah, let me just take your questions, inshallah. Sorry, if someone has to enter for USA for immigration or business requirement, should he treat the severity of corona as plague? Is to an area referring from going? So generally speaking, Brother Adil, from the spiritual and from the medical standpoint, you have to ask the medical doctor. But from a spiritual standpoint, this hadith, when it says, this hadith was talking about a particular area affected from Syria. So people of Medina they were asked not to go inside, because there was not an outbreak of plague in Medina at that time. But right now, coronavirus is a pandemic. Each and everywhere is coronavirus. It's globally. So whether you are going from, let's say, from the city of Worcester in Massachusetts to city of Boston, it's fine because everywhere is coronavirus. But generally, because doctors are saying don't leave, there's chance. If you don't have, you might get it from outside. And if you have, you will give it to people. So basically, that hadith will be applied in our social distancing and self-quarantine concept. Unless there is a need for the grocery, obviously that you have to go out. Otherwise, stay at home. Unless there is a desperate need, that without it, you won't survive. Then you can go. Otherwise, just stay at home, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us, inshallah. Can these slides be shared? Yes, sister, awesome. Slides will be shared. Actually, the document which I'm writing, a research paper, which have extra details, not only this, that will be shared tonight or tomorrow as a PDF with everyone, free of cost, inshallah. Okay, let's start now, inshallah. Okay, it is permissible based on our sunnah traditions to do khatm al-Quran by the community members and do dua. Asian practice by some people of South Asian descent. Please provide your quick comment. Khatm al-Quran for the pandemic. Any good deed you can do with the intention, okay, I'm doing this good deed and then I will be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm going to seek repentance. Then inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will going to accept that good deed, whether you are reciting Quran, understanding the Quran, reading the hadith, or going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as your intention is going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and doing good deed. But when you are actually doing this Khatm al-Quran to remove the plague, and doing Khatm al-Quran 536 times, then I don't know of any tradition, but we need to ask the sheikh or the scholars who are doing this at what's their evidence. And if there is, then just don't make a big deal. Generally speaking, we should try to look at the things which are permissible and recommended in Sunnah instead of trying to come up with our own methods. And if it's recommended by a local scholar, local imam, then just don't argue with them. Even if you don't agree with them, don't argue with them. And these are the times we don't want any disagreement within local Muslim community. These are the times that we want to bring everyone together, inshallah. So if you're doing Khatm al-Quran with an intention of doing good deed, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to accept your dua, inshallah, Allah will accept your dua, inshallah. Okay, let's move on now. Is it okay to Muslim recite still pray Zuhr? We'll come on that, brother Adam. Okay, contemporary fiqh issues from coronavirus. So we'll discuss a few things. As I told you this before, we'll discuss individual, first of all, the concept of concession in Islam. Second, individual missing 5 times salawat, not praying in masjid, they are praying at home. Is it permissible for them? Individual not praying Salatul Jum'ah, is it okay for them? If they are missing, if masjid is not having Salatul Jum'ah, should you pray Salatul Jum'ah at home or should you pray Salatul Zuhr at home? What about Salatul Taraweeh? What about Salatul Eid? What about deferring zakah because of the economical crisis and losing a job? Or what about as Islamic Center postponing the activities? All these questions will be answered right now, inshallah. And I'll try to give evidences from both these sides, inshallah. Let's start now, inshallah. So before we can start any fiqh principle, I just want you to understand concept of concession in Islam. This is extremely, extremely, extremely important. What does Allah say about giving concession and making religion easy for people? So let's start now. First is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah says, Allah has made this religion, it will make things easy for people and do not make things difficult for people. This is Surah Al-Baqarah number 185. Second, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to one of the companions, Imran ibn Husayn, who had the piles issue, a medical problem, and he asked that, can I pray while sitting or while lying? I cannot stand. So Rasulullah told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, صَلِّ قَائِمًا فَإِن لَمْ تَسْتَطِ فَقَاعِدًا فَإِن لَمْ تَسْتَطِ فَعَلَىٰ جَنْبٍ. Rasulullah says, in Bukhari, pray standing. If you do not have the ability, then pray sitting. If you don't have the ability, then pray lying down. No worries, but pray. Pray as much as you can, but you have an option because you have a legitimate excuse. Third, about the concession, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah number 185 have given concession to travelers, to the sick, and to the old people in terms of fasting in Ramadan. Allah have given them concession, subhanAllah. As we'll discuss in our fiqh of Ramadan class, starting from coming Monday, inshallah. from 7:30 to 8:30. Also, when it was windy and cold night in Medina, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered in Sahih Muslim, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered to the Muazzin to add this in Adhan, Sallu fi rihal, Sallu fi rihal. Pray at your home. Don't need to come to Masjid because it's windy, it's cold night. Pray at home. This is Sahih Muslim. And then one more thing. Due to rain and muddy roads, Ibn Abbas radiallahu an, once, he actually was sitting in the masjid and he asked his muazzin, because it was raining hard, it was muddy roads, he asked his muazzin, after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked his muazzin that in the adhan, instead of hayya ala salah, say sallu fi rihalikum, sallu fi buyutikum. Sahih Muslim. So as muazzin says, sallu fi rihalikum, sallu fi buyutikum, pray at your home, pray at your home. Then few sahaba who were in the masjid, few people who were in the masjid, they had the objection. And same Muslim, they said, why can you do this? If Jummah is an obligation, why can't they pray at home? Jummah, they cannot miss Jummah. And Ibn Abbas gave the most powerful response. Ibn Abbas did not say, oh, I am the companion, I'm the knowledgeable person, I'm the Hibra Ummah. Rasulullah says that Rasulullah made dua for me for having the knowledge. He didn't say this with such a higher knowledge. Ibn Abbas said, فَعَلَهُ هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّنِّي. Ibn Abbas said, you know what? Don't get mad. This was done by someone who is better than me. That's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his time, he did the same thing. The rain is raining, he advised. And he says, inna jum'a azmatun. That jum'a, praying Friday is obligation, I know. But there is a relief and concession given in the Sharia. Obviously, I don't want Muslims, he said, to come out in these rainy and muddy roads and harming themselves. Obviously, that the situation is very bad there in the deserts, back in the desert, it's rain, muddy roads are there. It really becomes difficult. Don't use, if it's a slight drizzle, you will miss the Jummah today because now we are living in different times, as said by these scholars. But if the snow is coming, then you have a legitimate excuse. Or if it's really a hurricane, thunderstorm, then it's a legitimate excuse. We'll talk about that, inshallah. One more thing about the concept of concession in Islam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I actually brought this hadith, I will bring this hadith again, about imam making mistakes in concession and leniency. He says it's better than imam making mistakes in severity. He says, اِذْرَأُوا الْحُدُودَ عَنِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُ مَخْرَجٌ فَخَلُّوا سَبِيلَهُ فَإِنَّ الْإِمَامَ يُخْطِيَ مِنْ فِي الْعَفْوِ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَنْ يُخْطِيَ فِي الْعُقُوبَةِ. He says, the imams, leaders, drop the hudud in case of doubt as far as possible, if there is a way out. Don't punish people. Clear the way for the people. No doubt, if the imam makes a mistake, an error in the side of leniency, it's better than he making a mistake in the side of severity. This is a concept of concession in Islam. Last thing before we can move on to the fiqh. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said about concession, inna deena yusr. Religion is extremely easy. وَلَنْ يُشَادَ الدِّينَ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا غَلَبَ. And no one overburdens himself in his religion, but he will not be able to continue in that way. وَصَدِّدُوا وَقَارِبُوا وَبْشِرُوا. So do not be extremist, but try to be near perfection and receive the good tidings that you will be receiving, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, we'll discuss it during Jummah Khutbah online, inshallah. I'll answer your questions, inshallah. First, just brief answer, no, virtual khutbah is not possible unless you are living in the hudud of the masjid, which is not in Western countries. So you can listen to the Jummah Khutbah and you can pray Zuhr Salah at home. It will still be Zuhr Salah with the spiritual reminder and benefit, inshallah, to compensate the deficiency. Okay, let's start now. Regarding prayer, praying five times congregational salah at home from an individual perspective. So the current outbreak of COVID-19 has resulted in lockdown in many, many countries, including here in US, which was unprecedented. The questions come though, what about five-time obligatory prayers? What about Jummah prayers? Let's start this. Just to let you know, please listen to this carefully as our many options have changed. Just listen to this. An individual going to the Jum'ah and going to the five-time Salah is different than a masjid postponing the Jum'ah altogether. Just keep this in mind. Again, there are two different perspectives. One is from the individual missing Jum'ah or any other obligatory Salah in Masjid. And second aspect is Islamic centers and imams in Masajid suspending Jum'ah and obligatory prayers altogether. I want both this point to be clear, and I'll talk about both, inshallah. Please keep this clear in your mind, inshallah. So let's discuss first from the individual perspective, okay? From an individual perspective, let's say Muhammad, Ahmad, Fatima, Maryam. Regarding praying five times congregational salah at home and not going to the masjid, even though we'll discuss it, inshallah. Is it allowed to pray at home and do not go in the congregational salah? So the answer is, from the individual perspective, when it comes to Islamic law for five-time prayers in congregation, listen to this carefully. As for the daily congregational prayers, majority of the scholars, except Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, except Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they say it's not obligatory to even pray in congregation, it's recommended. Only Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal say, no, it's obligation to pray in congregation. Is it clear? So there is already majority say it's not even an obligation. It's recommended. It's sunnah. You will still get the reward. Second, even the people who say, no, it's an obligatory to pray in congregation, even they didn't put the restriction to pray in the masjid. You can still have the obligatory prayers at home with your family. And these are the normal circumstances. I didn't even start the discussion of praying during the coronavirus. So just keep this in mind. We'll answer this question, inshallah, brother. It will come, inshallah. The majority of those who consider them obligatory did not demand their performance at masjid. Okay, now, when you can pray at home, according to all, majority of the scholars consider sickness is a legitimate excuse, or fear of getting sick is a legitimate excuse to miss the congregational prayer and to pray individually. Because Rasulullah was sick and he appointed Abu Bakr Siddiq to lead the people in Salah because he was sick. And this is the hadith which is used by almost all these scholars. During these times, you can pray in congregation at your home with family. Again, you can have the jama'ah, have the congregation at your home with your family. And according to majority of these scholars, you will get the reward, what is mentioned for the congregation, 27 times reward. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in Sahih Hadith, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ سَافَرَ كُتِبَ لَهُ مِثْلُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ مُقِيمًا صَحِيحًا. Rasulullah says, when a slave of Allah, when a servant of Allah suffers from illness or sets on a journey, he's credited with the equal or whatever good works he used to do when he was healthy or not at home. So now there's a legitimate excuse for you not going to the masjid. Stay at home, have a jama'ah with your family. If you are single, then get married so that inshallah, and may Allah make it easy for you. But if you are alone, then pray alone inshallah, and Allah is going to give you reward inshallah with praying with the congregation, because there is a legitimate excuse for you not going to masjid, for either you are sick or you have the fear of getting sick. And it's not just simple flu, it's about the deadly disease, which is coronavirus. Second question, regarding individual missing Jum'ah Salah. For individual Salah, we had this disagreement. Some scholars say it's wajib, some say it's sunnah to pray in congregation. But for Jum'ah Salah, this is a little less flexible. Regarding missing Jum'ah Salah from an individual perspective, again, we are discussing right now individual perspective. Out of fear, can we miss this Jum'ah Salah? First of all, we should keep this in mind. Jum'ah Salah is one of the rituals, sha'air of Islam. And it's an obligation on adult male, proven in the Quran, Sunnah, and consensus of the Ummah that it's an obligation on adult male. For women and for the kids, it's not an obligation, it's recommended. But for men, adult male, it's obligation. Rasulullah says, "Man taraka salasa jum'ain tahawunan biha taba'a Allahu ala qalbi." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever neglects the three Jum'ah, I'll talk about that inshallah. Rasulullah says, whoever neglects three Jum'ahs in a row out of negligence, out of ignorance, without any reason, means we will place a seal in his heart. That's the hadith of Rasulullah. If you miss three Jum'ah, a seal will be placed in your heart. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to do the actions to revive our heart, inshallah. Ameen, Ya Rab. Now, we'll talk about this, what in the current times, if you are missing Salatul Jummah, this hadith, all the scholars say, this is when you don't have any excuse, when you have to pray Salatul Jummah and you are missing Salatul Jummah without any legitimate excuse. Then if you miss three Jummah, your heart will be sealed. In Islamic law, even though Jummah Salah is that obligatory, but in Islamic law, there are legitimate reasons which allow an individual to miss Salatul Jummah according to all the four Imams. Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmad the Humble. We are talking about individual missing Jummah Salah. Okay? Let's discuss it right now. One, when can you miss Salatul Jummah? First, a traveler can miss Salatul Jummah. It's not an obligation on the traveler. Women can miss Salatul Jummah because it's not an obligation on women. Kids can miss Salatul Jummah. Sick or fear of getting sick, we'll talk about this inshallah, you can miss Salatul Jummah and you can pray at home. Heavy rain or muddy road in the deserts, you can still miss Salatul Jummah according to majority of these scholars. Risk of poverty and wealth being stolen if you will leave for Salatul Jummah, early scholars say, and even today, that actually yes, you can miss Salatul Jummah. One who is looking after a sick person, you are not sick, but you are looking after a sick person and you know that if you will leave for Jummah, that person will struggle. You are eligible to miss Salatul Jummah and actually you can pray Zuhr at home. SubhanAllah. Blind person, according to Hanafi only. Only Hanafi says, if you are blind, you can miss Salatul Jummah. Fear of livelihood, according to Hanbali, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, fear of livelihood, you can miss Salatul Jummah. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal says, if you are a bread maker and making a bread, and if you have a fear that if you pray go for a Jummah and come back, that bread will burn and you will have a loss of your livelihood, you can miss Salatul Jummah. These are the reasons when you can miss as an individual Salatul Jummah. There will be legitimate other reason. For the sick or fear of getting sickness as one of the reason, you have to take advice of the legal medical experts and medical authorities that have to be taken in serious consideration, because Shari'i scholar knows about the fiqh and Sharia. They don't know about the tib and the medical expertise. So how they define sickness and fear of sickness and what they are recommending, what they are suggesting, and that we're going to decide. So the conclusion of this, during the current pandemic, whether your masjid is open or closed, that's a different argument which is coming. I'll discuss about that. From an individual perspective, whether your masjid is open or closed, if your medical doctors are saying, stay away from gatherings, stay away from big gatherings, stay away from congregation, and I think they are saying this right now because whatever medical doctors I've heard, they are saying this, and you are afraid either for yourself that you will get sick or you are afraid that you will spread the virus, then this will be considered as a legitimate excuse that you can pray at home and not leave for Salatul Jummah. Regardless of your local masjid is having Jummah or they are not having Jummah, it will be a legitimate excuse. You can pray Zuhr or Jummah at home, we'll discuss that later inshallah. But again, for the individual, you can take this. For the collective, should masjid cancel or not, that's a different thing inshallah. Now the next question comes that should an individual who is not going for the masjid, should he pray Zuhr Salah or the Salatul Jummah? Before we can discuss from the Islamic Center's perspective, are they even allowed to postpone the Jummah? We'll discuss that. But before that, should an individual pray Zuhr Salah at home or should they pray Jummah in small gatherings at their home at work? If the masjid suspend the Salatul Jummah and suspend the five-time obligatory prayers. Classical scholars have a disagreement that whether you are allowed to pray Jummah at home if your masjid is closed or not, or masjid is not having Salatul Jummah. Are you allowed to pray Jummah at home? Classical scholars have a disagreement. There are scholars who have given permission, and then there are scholars who have denied this. They say, no, then pray Zuhr Salah. I'll just give you briefly their evidences, inshallah. So, without showing any biases, so inshallah, do whatever you feel to do, inshallah. Both are coming from classical standpoint. Let's discuss the evidence of the deniers of Jummah at home. The people who deny that there is no Jummah at home, this we need to pray Zuhr Salah, if local masjid is not having. What is their evidence? Scholars who claim that Jummah Salah cannot be prayed at home, first see their evidence. First evidence they give, that they say it's against the Maqasid al-Sharia. It will be against the objectives of Islamic law, which is considered for the obligation of Jummah. That is, to have big gatherings and to congregate once in a week. If masjid is not having because of a legitimate reason, then you should pray Salatul Zuhr. There's no point of having a small Jummah khutbah, 3, 4, 5 people everywhere. It just goes against the maqsad of the Jum'ah. Jum'ah comes from Jama'ah, which is gathering. They have a logical aspect to it. Second, they say Jum'ah is one of the rituals of Islam, and you have to perform as it is prescribed by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Khulafa al-Rashideen, four Khalifa after him. And they never prayed multiple Jum'ah in Medina. How can we have small Jum'ah and gatherings at each and every house, at our home? At the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people from the outskirts of Medina, they have to travel a lot to come into the city. Still, they would not have the second Jum'ah. How can you do this? That's the second evidence they use. And third evidence they use is that from the scholarly perspective, it's not proven. They would say that Hanbali and Shafi'i put the limit of 40 men at least you need to have for the legitimate Jum'ah khutbah. Maliki scholars put the condition that you can only pray Salatul Jum'ah in masjid, not outside of masjid. Hanafi scholars put the condition that you have to require permission of leader. How can you fulfill these guidelines by having a small Jum'ah at your home? So this group uses these guidelines primarily. There are others, but these are the primary guidelines. And they would say that you should pray Zuhr Salah at home and you'll get the complete reward. Do not pray Salatul Jum'ah at home. These are their evidences. Let's see the other side. The evidence of those who say it's permissible to pray Jum'ah at home. So first they say if your local masjid is not having Jum'ah khutbah, then the ayah of Suratul Jum'ah will still be applied for you and for your local community, and you have to establish Salatul Jum'ah at your work, at your home, as long as you have minimum quorum of people. Because Umar radiallahu anhu, during his khilafah, some of his companions asked him about, okay, what should we do for Salatul Jum'ah? And Umar radiallahu anhu wrote a letter, and he said in that letter, جَمِّعُوا حَيْثُمَا كُنْتُمْ. In Mustafa ibn Abi Shaybah from Sahih Hadith, he says, you have to pray Jum'ah wherever you are. Wherever you are, you have to pray Jum'ah. So this is the hadith and the evidence they use. The second evidence they use that you should pray Jum'ah small at your home is the majority of these scholars allow Muslims to establish Jum'ah outside of the masjid, except Imam Malik. Hanafis, Shafis, Hanbalis, they allow even to establish Jum'ah outside, as long as you have minimum quorum. So if majority allows, how can we say it's not permissible? So both the sides have evidence. When the classical scholars have disagreed, it's bound to happen that modern day scholars will disagree on these issues. My conclusion to you, you can do whatever suits your condition better, because both is proven. If you are at home, you can pray Zuhr Salah. If you have the minimum quorum, you can actually pray the Jum'ah if you want. Now, someone is asking me privately, what is a quorum for Salatul Jum'ah? Okay, so let me just tell you this quickly. The quorum for Salatul Jum'ah, how many people should have? There's a lot of disagreement. If you are praying Zuhr Salah, then you should not ask this question. If you are planning to establish a small Jum'ah at a school, at work, then you should ask this question. Then Hanbali and Shafi'i say that there have to be 40 men, which you need to have for Salatul Jum'ah. If you have 39 men, cannot pray Salatul Jum'ah according to Hanbali and according to Shafi'i. They have the hadith in Abu Dawud that the first Jum'ah which was established by Sahaba, they had 40 people. Second, if Maliki say that you need to have at least 12 men, not less than that. If you have 11 men, you cannot establish Jum'ah. That's Maliki. They have the evidence from the hadith where Rasulullah was giving khutbah to the companions, and some companions went out for the caravan and 12 were sitting in front, and that khutbah was still valid. So Imam Malik says 12 was the least number, otherwise the khutbah would have been invalid. Imam Abu Hanifa is easy in this regard, the easiest in terms of mazahib. Imam Abu Hanifa Hanafis have two opinions. One, the authorized position of the Hanafi mazhab, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, and the authorized position of the Hanafi mazhab, is that this is the position of Imam Zufar also, the student of Abu Hanifa, that one imam with three men outside, with three men at the back. You know why they are saying men? Because it's an obligation on men. So when the people who have an obligation on them, they have to be there. For women, for kids, and for the people who are excused, it's not an obligation on them. So that's why they put the restriction of men. Okay. So Imam Hanifa says one imam with three men at least need to be there. You can have as many women as you want, but you need to have three men because it's an obligation on them. And where he get this from? He says three people will make Jama'ah plural in Arabic. So along with one imam, you need to have three. Then in non-authorized Hanafi positions, it's that actually you can have one imam with two men, at least to have a legitimate Jummah khutbah. So three men along with imam. So one imam and two men. That will be considered as a legitimate, according to few students of Imam Abu Hanifa, like Muhammad al-Hassan al-Shaybani, Abu Yusuf. But this is non-authorized position in Hanafi mazhab. And this is actually selected by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah also. So one imam with two men. Then there is one position which is not endorsed by any of the four mazhab. But this is said by Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, Imam Shawqani rahimahullah, and Nir al-Awtar. He says that you need to have one imam and one man. That's it. That will be jama'ah. And the reason why Ibn Hazm and Imam Shawqani says this, they say that there is no hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is strictly putting restriction on these numbers. All these scholars, jazahumullahu khairan, they are putting their efforts to extracting from indirect texts. So why we should put this restriction? So you can do whatever you which mazhab you are following. And may Allah make it easy. If you're not following any mazhab, inshallah, then I would say follow the, to be on the safe side, follow the Hanafi position. Or if you want to find the most easy, like in high schools, I have to mention this, in high schools, if you want to have Jum'ah, they have only two men or three men, it's okay, inshallah. That will be accepted as long as you have, you are following any of these scholars, inshallah. Okay, let's start now. Actually, before that, let me take your questions, inshallah, so I can take some two-minute rest also, inshallah. Oh, subhanallah, this brother has sent me the thesis. Can we do Jummah online? No, you can listen to the Jummah khutbah online and you can pray Salat al-Zuhr at home. Because no imam have given, no scholars, no hadith, no sahaba, no tabi'in, that you can pray Salat al-Jummah while being apart millions of miles away or thousands of miles away or hundreds of miles away from each other. Someone asked me about this. Hadith Abu Huraira said, no prayer is harder for the hypocrites than the morning and the night prayers. And if they knew the reward for these prayers, certainly okay. So, okay, Fajr and Isha Salah. This hadith is used in regular circumstances. If you apply this hadith with the other hadith, you'll get the answer. Rasulullah himself, he asked Abu Bakr to lead certain amount of salah because he could not come out of sickness. So how you would reconcile the hadith? That, okay, this hadith in regular circumstances, but when you have a legitimate excuse, it's okay. And actually, I would say it's better. Who am I? The scholars have said, it's better in these circumstances to stay home. Because Rasulullah says, when you are eating onion and garlic, do not go to the masjid. And the reason for is, in Allah, in al malaika tata'azza min yata'azza min hum banu Adam, that angels feel harm just like from those things where human beings feel harm from that. So if you are not even allowed to go to masjid after eating onion and garlic because they will feel bad smell, what about spreading the deadly virus in the masjid? Can you imagine that? Subhanallah. So I would say when you compare this hadith, try to see that Prophet Muhammad himself missed the prayers while he was sick. So how can you reconcile that hadith, subhanAllah? Again, just try to follow local scholars, inshallah. So if we don't even have two men at home, and just one, and the rest of the one, you have to have two men, otherwise just pray Zuhr Salah, and you will get the reward completely, because you will be considered as the person who will have a legitimate excuse. So you don't have to, you will get the complete reward, inshallah, because you will have a legitimate excuse. What about Jummah in middle schools? As long as they fulfill the restrictions and whichever opinion they are following. How many Jummah can we miss? Regular circumstances, you cannot miss three Jummah. But in these times, it won't apply. As I said, to the majority, I said that you can still keep praying Zuhr as long as this pandemic will continue. Because that hadith of Tubi'a fi qalbihi, that heart will be sealed, is about when a person missed Jummah Salah intentionally. Not apply to this hadith. Can we start praying Jummah at home with family? One man and three women. No, there need to be at least two men. Jazakallah khairan. Can you do virtual khutbah? Virtual khutbah, how you define khutbah? Khutbah is a speech, generally speaking. So you do nikah khutbah also. It does not mean that you need to pray two rak'ah after nikah. But if you mean by virtual khutbah that, okay, you listen online to the sheikh and then you can pray two rak'ah at home for Jummah, no, it's not permissible. But you can listen to the speech virtually and pray Zuhr at home. This is acceptable according to all. Can we have its recording later? Inshallah, you will have. But you have to give me the fees. And the fees is that you have to make dua for all of us, including me, inshallah, and my family. My masjid is still open, but they combine Zuhr and Asr. We'll come on that, inshallah, brother Adam. We'll discuss it, inshallah. Imam, can you take a 1 minute break, grab water? Oh, brother Kamal, jazakallahu khairan. Okay, let's take I don't need breaks, subhanAllah, I have a water. We have to finish this and we only have a few minutes left, subhanAllah, and there's so many fiqhi discussions have to come. So you can, inshallah, send me the questions, inshallah. Minimum requirement of the khutbah, you just need to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to send blessings and salawat on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you need to recite one ayah of the Quran. That's it. That can be done within 30-35 seconds. If you know Arabic, that's better. Some majority say it have to be in Arabic, or say it can be in a local language. So basically, this can be your khutbah. أحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Khutbah is done. Repeat the same thing in second time. Say it in English. If you don't know Arabic, that's fine. This is a minimum requirement. For detail, come into our fiqh classes. We discuss what are the requirements of the Jummah khutbah. Okay, let me begin because we have to cover so many things. And then you can keep asking. I will come to this, inshallah. Okay. What about the remaining recommended acts on Friday? So Jummah is not happening in your masjid. You are at your home praying Zuhr according to a group of scholar or praying Jummah according to a group of scholar. And Allah will reward both of you, inshallah, because the nature of this disagreement is like actually the Sahabas disagree with each other. Apart from Salah, which is not happening in the masjid, all other things which are recommended in on Friday, including taking shower, which is highly recommended in the four mazahib, reading Surah Al-Kahf, wearing nice outfit, putting perfume, is still recommended. So you can still take shower, you can still wear nice outfit, you can still put perfume, you can still recite Surah Al-Kahf and it will be recommended. Can we stand apart from praying each other while praying in congregation? This is another question. Can we, again, stand apart from each other while praying in congregation? Again, the reason why it's an important question to ask nowadays is because doctors have advice at least 6 feet away. At least 6 feet away. In regular circumstances, when we are praying Salah in congregation, what should we do? So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first of all, you need to understand regular circumstances, when there is no disease, when there is no viral infection, coronavirus, in regular circumstances, it's not permissible. Or at least it's makruh tahrimi, that you will leave 6 feet gap or 5 feet gap between two people who are praying right next to each other in jama'ah of congregation. Hadith says, أَقِيمُ الصُّفُوفُ وَحَاذُوا بَيْنَ الْمَنَاكِبْ وَصُدُّ الْخَلَلْ. That is straight in the rows, is stand shoulder to shoulder and fill the gaps. This is the hadith in Abu Dawud. So the scholars say it's an obligation according to some, and Hanafi say it's makruh tahrimi, a extremely disliked act to leave gap between two people praying together. To manifest the love, to manifest the bond of brotherhood, that there is no distance between me and you, pray right next to each other. That is why it's discouraged highly or haram. But even in regular circumstances, I'm not even talking about coronavirus right now, even in regular circumstances, despite of the fact it is highly encouraged to fill the gaps between the rows in regular circumstances, but still, if you will leave the gap of 6 feet, even in regular circumstances, your salah will still be valid, although it's haram. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah says, مَا الْقَوْلِ بِأَنَّ تَصْوِيَةَ وَاجِبَ فَصَلَاتُ مَنْ خَالَفَ وَلَمْ يُصَوِّ صَحِيحَ. He says, although we say that straightening the rows is fard, is obligation, but the prayer of one who does not do it will still be valid. Now let's discuss it. When it becomes a medical necessity, if you're praying in congregation, leave 6 feet gap. Like in COVID-19 coronavirus times, even if you are having Jummah at your home, inviting your 2-3 neighbors, let's say, that, okay, let's have a minimum quorum for 3-4 men. Can we pray apart from each other? Then contemporary scholars have given permission that during these times, it's okay. Taba'ud ani sufuf. Even including the scholars whom I actually mentioned the name early from the Saudiya, from Medina, Sheikh Khalid from Qasim, who's a senior scholar in Jamia Islamia. He actually wrote on this. He says it's permissible to take a distance because there will be harm if you're going to stay close. And harming someone is not acceptable in Islam. So it's permissible for a need, but generally it's not advisable. Now, can we suspend Eid Salah? Can we suspend Eid Salah? I hope and I pray that we all can pray Eid Salah with our congregation in our masajid. Ameen, 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 Ya Rab. And situation will get better, inshallah, before that, inshallah. Ameen, Ya Rab. Ameen, Ya Rab. But you know what? If it gets worse or stays the same, then this is an important question to ask. What is the status of Salatul Eid? Is it a mandatory? Salatul Eid is mandatory according to Hanafi, and it's a communal obligation according to Hanbalis. For Shafis and Malikis, it's a Sunnah. For Shafis and Malikis, it's Sunnah. But if there is a fear of harm, as reported by local health authorities or government, that have put restriction on the faith-based gatherings, like in Massachusetts, we cannot have more than 10 people get together, even in faith-based gatherings, then it's okay to suspend any faith-based gathering, like we discussed about the five-time Salah and Jum'ah Salah, including Eid Salah, because Eid Salah is less in terms of intensity than Jum'ah Salah. In Jum'ah Salah, no one says it's Sunnah. Everyone says it's Fard. At least you have Shafi and Hanbali, they say it's recommended. So there is less intensity. Hope we don't have to do it because you pass Ramadan and you won't go into the masjid for Eid, then subhanAllah, how it will feel. But eventually you have to understand if there is a potential harm, if this will increase, situation will not get better, then it's a legitimate excuse to not to have Salatul Eid. Can we pray Salatul Eid at home? So if you don't have Eid Salah in the congregation, if government have put the restrictions on the faith-based gatherings, then can you pray Salatul Eid at home? Hanafis and Maliki say that you cannot make up Salatul Eid, period. Hanafis and Maliki say you cannot make up Salatul Eid at home. Hanbalis and Shafis and Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, they say you can actually pray Salatul Eid at home. There's a long discussion on this. You can pray Salatul Eid at home. But at the same time, Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, selected the position of Hanafis and Shafis. I'm sorry. Hanbalis and Shafis says you can pray Salatul Eid. Ibn Taymiyyah says what Hanafis and Maliki says that you cannot make up Salatul Eid. That's the right opinion because it just kills the purpose of Eid gathering. If you have a small Eid khutbah, again, the same argument which you had in Salatul Jummah. Hugging, shaking hands, visiting your loved ones at the time of Eid is recommended, but generally, if the situation gets worse, not visiting them will be recommended. You will get reward for not visiting them. Just text them and congratulate them for Eid Mubarak. If the situation gets worse, I hope and pray that inshallah, situation will get better inshallah. Shaking hand is better regular in the regular circumstance, but in these circumstances, if situation gets bad and we reach to the Eid, it's better not to do this, not to hug. Because of legal maxim, ad-darar yuzal, everyone agree that harm must be removed. Can we suspend Taraweeh? Salat al-Taraweeh. Again, Sheikh Khalid and Sheikh Rahili argues in their research on this topic. Can you suspend Taraweeh? Taraweeh is not a wajib obligation. Taraweeh is not a wajib obligation according to all. No one says it's wajib. It is a voluntary prayers, which with a great reward. Man qama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi. Rasulullah says, whoever prays Taraweeh, the night prayer in Ramadan, they will going to get reward that all of their sins, previous sins will be forgiven. Subhanallah. Such a high reward, but it's not an obligation. Remember this. In fact, there is a big disagreement among our great imams of fiqh, whether praying Salatul Taraweeh at home is better or praying Salatul Taraweeh in masjid is better, with jama'ah. Majority say praying Salatul Taraweeh with jama'ah in masjid is better. Majority of the scholar. But there is a minority scholarly opinion which says that praying Salatul Taraweeh at home is better than praying in the masjid. Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah. Although that's not the majority, but I'm telling you how flexible is our religion. Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, asked this question to his teacher, Imam Malik, rahimahullah. He mentioned this in his book, Al-Umm. He says, Imam Malik, what is better, praying Taraweeh at home or praying Taraweeh at masjid with jama'ah? So he says, if praying at home will make your iman stronger, if praying at home will protect you from riya, from showing off, then praying at home is better. Otherwise, pray in masjid. That's just because that's what the habit of the Sahaba after Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh. That's not the majority. Majority says still praying in masjid is better. The point is, subhanAllah, that classical scholars even disagree on this. This is on the regular circumstances. During these times of pandemic, when the masjids have suspended their Jum'ah and their five-time obligatory prayer, there's no point of even asking what about non-obligatory prayers. It's a situation that still remains the same, if not get worse. then it's okay for masjid to suspend and not to have Taraweeh, and you can still pray Taraweeh at your home. You can pray Taraweeh at your home. If you don't have Hafiz al-Quran, no worries. You can actually recite whatever memorization you have done, or in Hanbali and in Shafi'i Mazhab, you can open the Mushaf in the Salah and you can read from that. Hanafis disagree, and Maliki say it's not permissible in Fard Salah, but in Nafil and Taraweeh, you can actually open the Mushaf. The matter is extremely broad. So you can pray Taraweeh at home. Let's discuss it, inshallah. This is the last slide. I will end, I'm promising I will end, and I'll take your questions, inshallah, because I'm done. My throat is gone almost. Okay. Brother Shafiqur Rahman, when you try to make complicated things simple, it's a red flag. When you try to make complicated things simple, it's a big red flag. These issues are there. I'll give you an example. You think this issue is a disagreement, is complicated. I had the face surgery 3 years ago. I had an injury on my face. My cheekbone went inside playing cricket. And there were 2 maxillofacial surgeons available at that time. My cheekbone went inside. My face was unbalanced. So one maxillofacial surgeon said that we have to cut your face from here. We have to cut your face from here. And we have to pull it back. And then we have to do the facial surgery after that. There's 2 surgeries, because there will be marks, scars on your face. The another surgeon said that actually we have to do the face surgery from here so that we won't have any marks here. So we only have to do one surgery. We don't have to follow it up with facial surgery. So there were ikhtilaf. Medical doctors were having ikhtilaf. Things were complicated? No. Things were beautiful for me. I could pick whatever I find it suitable. So what I did, I said instead of 2 surgery, 1 surgery is better. Although it's a longer route from here, you will go and phone. So I trusted the doctor. Both were great medical doctors. Both wanted good for me. I selected this one so that I could avoid facial surgery. And alhamdulillah, this happened. This is what we need to do. If one opinion is difficult and creating hardship for you, even if you are following that, then it's okay to follow other opinion in the times of hardship. Yes, Hamli and Shafi said that you can actually do the jada. Well, yeah, Brother Shafiqur Rahman, may Allah reward you immensely. I'll try to answer all of your questions, inshallah, after this, inshallah. Let's discuss the most spicy issue right now. We discussed from the individual. Now let's discuss. Suspending the masjid for Jummah khutbah and for 5-time daily prayers as an Islamic masjid board and as an imam. This is not for you. This is for the board members, shura members of the masjid, imams, like myself. When can we do this? You might say, oh, what's the difference? We can apply the same principle for an individual. No, there's a difference. So just let me tell you why it's different. You remember the hadith where Muazzin was asked that if it's raining, just announce sallu fi buyutikum, pray at your home, you don't need to come. They were allowing the people who are already at home, do not come into the masjid. But azan was given, Ibn Abbas was there in the masjid, the people who have an objection, they were in the masjid. So salah have to be established. So from a board perspective or masjid perspective or imam perspective, when they will make a decision to actually postpone, this is less flexible than from an individual perspective. Now, no coronavirus, inshallah, hopefully, inshallah, may Allah protect all of us. I'm speaking so much. So I just got to talk. I hope and pray and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, inshallah. If the government authorities or the local public health authorities in a particular city or county or state or country have banned the faith-based gatherings or advised the suspension of these gatherings, not even one person, banned complete, because of the potential harm, then this constitutes a legitimate excuse to pray at home and to suspend the Jummah and 5-time obligatory prayers. I don't know of any classical scholar where the government is asking for complete shutdown of the faith-based gatherings and they are saying we should rebel the government for a legitimate reason of maslaha, not because of animosity of Muslims, for the health reason. I don't know of any classical opinion. Then you will ask where there is disagreement. There is a disagreement. The disagreement comes when the local city doesn't ask you for a complete shutdown, but local city have put the restriction on certain numbers, that instead of a complete ban on faith-based gatherings, local city, governor, Department of Health, Public Health, they would say, okay, you cannot gather more than 10 people, or you cannot gather more than 3 people, or you cannot gather more than 25 people, and so on and so forth. At that time, should we take a proactive approach and suspend all the activities? Or should we keep doing on until they will ask for a complete shutdown? That's where the scholars of disagree. Is it clear? Now let's discuss one by one and their evidences. And again, I'll give you on the balanced approach between both and both their evidences, inshallah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give me the articulation for this, inshallah. So let's start. And by the way, the nature of their disagreement is like the disagreement of the companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they were facing the unique plague in Syria. Remember in the beginning I was saying that was unprecedented, even this is unprecedented. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincerely ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward all of our contemporary scholars for their juristic effort, for their ijtihad to find the truth, regardless of which side they took. May Allah reward them all. Ameen, Ya Rab. Let's start. The evidence for those who give permission to suspend the activities in masjid, even though government haven't asked you for a complete shutdown and they have put restriction on the numbers like 10, 3, 25. I'll give you their evidence and then I'll give the evidence on the other side. Some scholars in this group, this is that that even though the government have recommended and not yet put a strict restriction, we should check our local medical authorities and almost all the medical doctors who are saying that we should avoid gatherings based on the potential harm which everyone have, and this constitute a legitimate reason, darar, harm, because this is a hardship which is applied collectively. And they argue that this coronavirus outbreak is affecting people. It's actually the case of harm, because you don't even have symptoms, because the medical doctors are saying, and this group of scholars take the medical advice seriously, that okay, you cannot even ask people who are with symptoms not to come to masjid, because the symptoms will start late, but you are going to give it to other people before even symptoms will start. So that's why it's better to take proactive approach according to this group of scholar and to suspend all the activities in masjid, because ad-dararu yuzal, this is a legal maxim proven from all the four mazhab, from Hanafi to the Hanbali, including khutbah, which should not be done in regular circumstances, but here we have to do this. This group say also that there is no benefit of asking the sick people not to come, because in coronavirus, medically speaking, symptoms are coming late, so you will able to harm other people. Also, this group of scholar uses lot of legal maxims. One is ad-dararu yuzal, harm must be removed. Second is al-mashakka tajlabu al-taysir. Again, this is agreed upon legal maxims from all these scholars or schools of thought. Hardship begets ease. So when the matter gets hard, you need to provide easiness. One maxim they use, removing harm, mafsada, will take precedence over secure benefit, maslaha. So they use all this and they would say, let's keep the masjid closed. From the historical fact, this group say that we have a historical fact also. Imam Zahabi mentioned in his book, Tariqh al-Islam, in the year almost 448 Hijri or 488 Hijri, maybe 448 Hijri. The famine which affected the area of Egypt and Andalus, in his book Tariqh al-Islam, he says the area of Egypt and Andalus was affected by famine, and there was a huge epidemic, pandemic hitting hard Cordoba area. He wrote in that time, there was a lockdown and no one was praying in masjid. So this is something, وَمَاتَ الْخُلْقِ بِالْأَشْبِيلَ بِحَيْثُ أَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدْ بُخِيَدْ مُغْلَقَ مَعْلَهَا مَنْ يُصَلِّ فِيهَا يُسَمَّ عَمُ الْجَوَ الْكَبِيرِ. And that year was called as year of great starvation. So that's something which is mentioned in the history books which they uses. In the time of writing or making this presentation, most of the countries in Middle East have shut down their activities, postponed their Jummah and five times Salah, including the Saudiya. Most of the masajids in the US, I won't use the word most, but majority of the masajids in the US have done the same thing. There are some masajids which are still doing, I'll give their arguments in the second evidence. And they use the word that this harm is real. It's affecting majority of the people. This is not perceived harm, according to this group of people. Okay, now let's see evidence for those who doesn't give permission to suspend the activities in Masjid. So the evidence for those who doesn't give permission to suspend the activities in Masjid. Now, which argument these scholars have? They say, if government haven't put restriction, and if they have only recommended or ban on certain number of people, that okay, not more than 10, then you should have Jummah for with 10 people. And we should not gather more than 10 because we have to abide by the government guidelines. And we should continue prayer 5 times a day because canceling Jummah, especially canceling Jummah, that's actually Sha'ir of Islam, one of the rituals of Islam. That is not easy case. We cannot cancel this just on the perception. Government have to ban that. So if the government have put restriction on to 10 people, maximum in faith-based gathering, we would still gather 10 people. Because it's the matter of the ritual of Islam, we cannot cancel it. They also use the evidence a certain Hanafi and Shafi'i scholar advised to recite Kunut-e-Nazila, to ask Kunut-e-Nazila. This is one of the special du'a. Whenever any calamity hits, you can actually ask this du'a in your obligatory prayers. Just like Vitr, in Vitr you ask the Kunut. So Hanafi and Shafi'i scholars say that in the classical work of the Hanafi and Shafi'i in small number of Hanbalis, they mentioned that during the time of plague, you should ask this du'a. So they say, you are asking not to pray in the Masjid, and Kunut-e-Nazila is being prescribed in the some mazahib. So how can you do that? So masajid have to open for this kunut, for this dua. The counter argument can be that you can ask the Kunut-e-Nazila when you have the jama'ah at home, if you don't need to go to masjid. Or the counter argument that you never had coronavirus like this, that a person who is praying right next to you, he already have the coronavirus without showing symptoms. Or the counter argument to this Kunut-e-Nazila thing will be, maybe that is affected in that one area, and the other area of the other Muslims are asking Kunut-e-Nazila. So there's back and forth argument. This group of scholar gives another counter argument that to consider coronavirus as a harm and to cancel the to postpone the Jummah and postpone 5 time prayers is an inappropriate understanding of the word harm, because they say the classical scholars define the word harm, and this is not complicated. That's why I said that this is complicated. One is that it should be real, haqiqi, not zanni, perceived. So if the doctors are declaring, testing you positive, then you should not come to masjid, then you have a real harm. But if you are not tested positive, then you're not having symptoms or so anything, then it won't be conceived as a harm. We won't close the masjid for them. The counter argument to them is that because of the nature of coronavirus, it's unprecedented virus, the medical authorities, you need to consult if you don't have the knowledge. And they are saying that this will be harmful even when the person will develop symptoms. So there is counter argument. The second evidence which they say that this is not harm, that it's not excessive. They would say only few people are struggling with this virus. The majority of us does not even have symptoms. So how can you actually apply this harm and just shut down the masajid? The counter argument is what is excessive is very subjective. When you explain fahish, excessiveness, it's very subjective. And you have to go back to local custom, how they define what's excessive. So in our times, medical authorities are saying it's extremely contagious, so this will be excessive. So there's back and forth evidence. Even historical fact, this group of scholars have historical evidence that during the time of plague, the masajid were not closed. Our advice after listening to both these sides, my advice to you. I'm not a scholar, I'm just a random person like you. After listening and doing research on this topic from both the angles, even though we saw the contemporary scholars are having disagreement in this regard, and may Allah reward all of them, inshallah, for their juristic effort for their ijtihad, but I will advise to my beloved audience, this was actually for the Masajid Board and Masajid Imam. For you as an individual, stay home. Inshallah, Allah will reward you. Allah will reward you more for staying at home, inshallah, until things will get better. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make things easy. Regardless, your masjid is open or closed, that's a different thing. That's not your problem. That's the problem of the masjid board and imam to handle. You as an individual should stay home, inshallah. Okay, last truth. Just let me finish this before, inshallah, we can take quick questions, inshallah, all together. Can we combine the prayer during COVID-19? So it's a big topic about combining the prayers. The scholars, first of all, generally disagreed is combining prayers, Zuhr with Asr and Maghrib with Isha, is permissible or not. Hanafi says it's not permissible except you are in the Hajj for Arafah and Muzdalifah, except you cannot combine for anything. Can we combine for the fear of coronavirus? Hanbalis, Malikis, and some Shafi'is say fear can be used. Fear can be used for combining prayers, and whether you have a fear of any plague or any disease like coronavirus. The evidence they have is indirect evidence, not the direct evidence. And the evidence they have is in Sahih Muslim, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, it's a long incident. He says, Jama'a Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bayna al-zuhr wal-asr, bayna al-maghrib wal-aisha, min ghayri khawfin wala matarin. He said, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam combined zuhr with asr and maghrib with aisha without any fear and without any rain. This is a hadith in Sahih Muslim. Hanafis doesn't agree with this. Ibn Taymiyyah says we should not make this a habit that without any reason you are combining prayer. But if you do once in a blue moon, Ibn Taymiyyah says it's fine. The other scholars say that no, there are other principles to understand this. But anyway, why I'm telling you this, especially the word without any fear, that Rasulullah combines Zuhr and Asr and Maghrib and Isha prayer without any fear. So it means what? It means what? That with fear, they used to combine. Right? If he says, okay, something strange happened in front of me, that without fear you combine, and you would say Rasulullah would do that, it means that with fear, it was permissible. So that's the evidence of the Hanbali, Maliki, and some group of Shafi. That it indicates during the time of fear was a legitimate excuse to join prayers, else Ibn Abbas would not have said it. Radiallahu anhu, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim. But the majority of the scholars who said that combining for fear is okay, Zuhr with Asr and Maghrib with Isha, even they said this combining have to be done only in masjid. For a coronavirus, now you're not going to masjid, you're praying at home. Majority of them, except few Hanbalis, they say that you cannot combine. Yes, Hanbalis say, you can combine, and you'll get reward. So the matter is brought. I would say follow the majority. You're praying at home, so pray on it in its time. Or if you want to do it not as a habit, then some Hanbalis say that actually you can do it, like Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah. May Allah reward us all. But again, majority say if you're not in the masjid, you cannot use this to combine. Okay. Muslims who die with coronavirus, how do the washing, shrouding, and funeral prayers for them? I'm not answering this. Sheikh Yasser Qadi have answered this for an American Muslim. There are Saudi Muslims can refer to the documents given by Sheikh Rohaili. You can see their argument. And Sheikh Khalid also have a beautiful document on this from Medina. And for the subcontinent Middle East, there are scholars there who have answered this question on YouTube. Refer to them. So again, Sheikh Yasser Qadi have a great video, and MJA have a great fatwa on this. I will skip that. How to give the funeral rites. If you want to ask me, you can ask me briefly on the questions, inshallah. The last two things. Can I defer my zakah next year because of the current crisis in economy? Regarding delaying of zakah payments, first of all, can I give zakah early for 3 years? Yes, you can give. Regarding delaying the zakah payments, the fundamental ruling is that zakah must be paid immediately when it's due, according to majority. Otherwise, you will get a sin. So if it's zakah on due right now, let's say on 1st of April or 1st of May, then you have to give, otherwise you will be sinful. It becomes mandatory every year, you know, the principle. Majority of the fuqaha scholars say that have declared it to be impermissible to delay the payment of zakah beyond its obligatory time frame. And it's immediate obligation, so you have to give. I'll give you this. So whoever has enough money to pay the obligatory zakah and enough remaining to suffice for their family, for personal living expense, as well as those of the family in the prescribed manner, it is an obligation to promptly pay zakah when it's due. This is further stressed due to the need of the poor of assistance, which is greater than any other at this time. But anyway, now let's see. If you are talking about, is there any exception if the economy is hard, you are now jobless? Majority say no, but Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, he actually have this. He says, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, says regarding the permissibility of delaying zakah. So you won't give zakah, you defer, and you will give twice next year. And he cited this evidence of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. He says he did not collect the zakah for a year due to people's need when the drought came in the Medina, but then collected it the following year. Regardless of the presence of this concession in the Hanbali mazhab, majority say you should give zakah right on time. Because if you have more than the nisab level, then it means you can give zakah. So this is the answer to the question. But again, there is a concession given by Hanbali Mazhab. If you really think that by saving this, you can not go into the stress and disease and health and so on and so forth, then there is evidence. But believe me, inshallah, by giving zakah on time, inshallah, you will going to get a lot more in return, inshallah, because that's an obligation and that's a right of the people, inshallah, which is bounding on you. Okay, so if you have any question, inshallah, now you can ask me. I'm done, and I'll try to answer your few questions before we can end this, inshallah. Let me go up, inshallah. Subhanallah, there's so jazakallah khairan. Okay. By praying Taraweeh, is the forgiveness for minor and major sin both? No, only for minor sin. Major sin, you have to seek forgiveness, as mentioned in the hadith. Only minor hadith. No, a question, but a general comment. The concern is that the situation fundamentally changes the basics of how we going about things, doing things to Islam once this crisis is over. Shaking hands, hugging, eating, drinking as a community during the halakas. May Allah make it easy for us. Ameen, Ya Rab. Ameen, Ya Rab. To help us to become better humans coming out of this. Okay, Ameen, Ya Rab. Asif, can you please put this ayah into perspective? Maybe that will overtake you in 45 hours if good happens to them. Yeah. I'll tell you, inshallah. So, as I said, subhanAllah, death is inevitable. Whether you will die with coronavirus or you will die with someone else, eventually people have to die. Death is inevitable, and that have to be our belief. And that should not create so much panic, subhanAllah. See, if you are a non-Muslim who believe this is the only life, then there is every reason for you to get panic. Because this is your life. It's my life, as Bon Jovi says. After this, there is no life. But we believe that this is just the start. The real life is coming. So even if you will die after taking preventive measures, eventually, inshallah, we have a better world to come. So it's just about testing the belief and asking yourself, subhanAllah, eventually that is inevitable. It's an undeniable fact. No one denies of that. I can skip that. May Allah give us the ability and yaqeen. But again, we have to take precaution. We have to take preventive measures as Umar ibn Khattab did. I'm not sure if you have mentioned this, but can Eid prayer be postponed to a later date, like a week? It can only postpone to 3 days. Eid prayers can be only postponed to 3 days. If you're Maliki, it cannot be postponed, but according to Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, it can be postponed to 3 days maximum. That's it. Jazakallah for reminding this. Kick of Janaza video is being given on YouTube. Again, it's given. Okay, I think now we are almost set. While his caller is talking, we should listen to him with full attention. We have to be respectful. Other interventions can be hold and chill later on. We have to be respectful of the other information. When talking, we should listen to him with full attention. We have to okay, then Jazakumullah khairan, Rashad. May Allah reward you immensely. How do the funeral during these times, if it wasn't specified about cause of death? Example, elderly person died in nursing home. See, you need to check. Generally, it's a communal obligation to wash the body. If they are not saying, the medical experts are not saying that the person died out of coronavirus and the body is infectious, then it's a communal obligation and then you have to wash. And if no one will wash, then the entire community will get sin. But if the only exceptions will come that you can skip the washing and the shrouding and so on and so forth, when medical experts suggest you to do that. So again, for detailed information, look at this video by Sheikh Yasir Khali. I don't want to repeat myself. He's far more better speaker in terms of knowledge, in terms of wisdom. So listen to him, inshallah. We DM'd a fatwa for this, which is beautiful. I would recommend Brother Nabil or Brother Ibtihaj or Brother Kamal, if you can post the Amja fatwa on the funeral also about this. These days we have technology and we are connected, just like people pray downstairs in cafeteria while connected through cable. Why can't we apply the same logic on larger scale, saying Imam leading the prayer from Marlboro? And also, this is a very good question. So, one thing, if you are in the hudud of the masjid, then it's permissible. Like in the haram, if the haram hudud is like wide open, you can still be in the library of the Masjid Nabawi and you can still pray and still you can actually get the reward. But if you're outside of the hudud means the premises, the declared hudud of the premises, then you cannot do this. This is declared upon. No one in the 1400 year history have done this. There is no single classical scholar, even after this technology have come, have said it, and there is a wisdom behind it. I've given a fatwa on this also, so I would recommend to read that. the summary of that is that if you are sitting in Marlboro and if you, people are sitting in Worcester, there is almost 25, 30, 35, 40 miles difference. There is no scholar classical who have given the permission that, okay, 30 miles, 40 mile difference is permissible. It's few miles here and there. If you're praying right next to each other, that's okay. If you are in the premises of the masjid, that's okay. These were the things which we discussed. But generally speaking, no one have given the statement. We should not do anything unique. And you know what? Once this situation will get better, ask this logic. Okay, virtual khutbas are permissible. Okay, tell us. Then we should have only one masjid Kaaba. Close Masjid Nabawi, close Bayt al-Maqdis, close all the masajid, and let's follow virtually the Kaaba. There's no need to have masjid. This logic is going against our entire Islamic text, right? Close Masjid Nabawi also, close everything. But this is not real. And when situation will get better, then eventually there will be chaos in the community. So that's why I would say, keep following these scholars. I haven't heard a single classical scholar, who have said that you can actually pray virtually. You can listen to the khutbah, but you have to still abide by the Sharia laws. Where we can find recording of this, hopefully on YouTube, inshallah, or actually you can find recording on our Facebook page, hopefully, inshallah, very soon, inshallah. Imam Asif Hirani Facebook page, or Worcester Islamic Center Facebook page, or ICNA Facebook page, inshallah, you can find on that, inshallah. Okay, so inshallah, with that, I will just announce this and I will end, inshallah. I'm writing a research paper on this. If you want me to email you this research paper, please, please give your email in the chat box, inshallah, so we can email you. It will be published today or tomorrow as a PDF. We'll send it to all of you, inshallah, about this. And I've used that 8-9 different research paper in the Arabic and in Urdu and different languages and tried to combine that, inshallah. That will help as a Muslim what we should do. Stay connected with your medical authorities. Try to get practical advice. Clean your hands as much as you can. Do not go out unless there is a need. Wear gloves or stay away from the handshakes. But please, please, please follow the advice of the medical authorities and the CDC and EPH, Department of Public Health. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all our loved ones during this time. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift this, to remove this virus from the face of the earth. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give the rank of shahada to those Muslims who passed away, as confirmed from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakumullahu khairan. I love you for the sake of Allah, and stay safe. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.